be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, on this blessed Sunday, make us worthy to praise your resurrection with pure hearts and with clear consciences. With all the children of your holy church, we glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the good and merciful Lord, who in his compassion came down to us and became flesh. He chose to taste death to save us, and he descended to the realm of the dead. By his resurrection he gave joy to his disciples and gave light to all the nations. With the light of his salvation. To the good one be glory and honor on this blessed Sunday and all the days of our lives, now and forever.
Amen.
O Word of God, who can adequately place you for the depth of your compassion? And what voice can bless you, for you are above all praise. Neither mind nor tongue can describe the wonders you accomplished on Sunday, the day of your resurrection from the dead. And so with the psalmist David we cry out, "This is the day the Lord has made, let us rejoice in it and be glad." Now, O Christ, our God, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense which we offer to you, to forgive our sins, give peace of mind to those in distress, and comfort to those who are anxious. Bring back those who are far and watch over those who are near. Guide the shepherds, sanctify the priests, and purify the deacons. Pardon all sinners and guard the righteous. Protect orphans and help widows. Drive away all conflicts and put an end to all dissension. Remember the faithful departed and grant them the rest in your heavenly kingdom, that with them we may celebrate that eternal feast. We raise glory to you, to your blessed Father, and to your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Let us pray.
O Lord, accept the sweet fragrance of our incense and make us worthy to announce your resurrection, along with all the angels to proclaim it with your women disciples, and to rejoice in it with your pure apostles. We raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Kadishat Aloho. Shout with joy from the mountains, Sunday is a feast so great. Offer praise to the Lord God, and with angels celebrate.
Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians.
Baruch Mu Rabun.
Glory to the Lord of Paul and the apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, and your children forever.
Brothers and sisters, as a body is one, though it has many parts, and all the parts of the body, though many, are one body, so also Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free persons, and we were all given to drink of one Spirit. Now you are Christ's body, and individually parts of it. Some people God has designated in the church to be first, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then, mighty deeds, then, gifts of healing, assistance, administration, and varieties of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work mighty deeds? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts. Praise be to God always.
Alleluia.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad.
More of the Holy Land, the praise, glory, and honor, and also the Trinity. Burn this incense. Kyrie eleison. Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew, who proclaim life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you.
The Lord Jesus says, "Behold, I am sending you as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be astute and shrewd as serpents and as simple as doves. But beware of men, for they shall hand you over to courts, and they shall scourge you in their synagogues, and you shall be led before governors and kings for my sake, as a witness before them and before the pagans. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say. You will be given at that moment what you are to say, for it shall not be you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother shall hand brother over to death, and the father his children. And children shall rise up against parents and have them put to death. You shall be hated by all because of my name. But whosoever endures to the end shall be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to another. Amen, I say to you, you shall not finish the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. No disciple is above his teacher. No slave is above his master. It is enough for the disciple that he become like his teacher, for the slave to become like his master. If they have called the master of the household Beelzebul, then how much the more those of his own household? This is the truth. Peace be with you. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So what's happening in this letter to the Corinthians is they're all bickering among themselves about who's the better Catholic, who's got better gifts, who's bringing more to the parish, who's not bringing more to the parish. And St. Paul is just simply saying, enough, basta, okay, stop. Everyone has their place within the body of Christ. And the section, which is not quoted in your bulletin today, we actually wind up skipping. It is just all the analogy of the members of a body. And we all have the experience. You know, you stub your toe and the rest of your body immediately stops. And then your mouth usually says naughty things at the same time. One member may be affected, and the whole body has a reaction to it. And he says, you have to understand that the body of Christ is like any other body in that way. Every member has a value that it brings. He says, and we actually garb the more dishonorable, what we call considered dishonorable, is garbed with more honor. Think of clothing. And the things that we think of more honorable, the eyes, the face, have total need. He says, it's ridiculous for the eye to say to the feet, I have no need for you. You're gross. You walk in the dirt. Yuck. Well, the eye wouldn't go very far if it just rolled around in a circle. And so he says, that very simple image is the same way here. Why are you arguing over gifts that God gives you? You each have your place within the body of Christ. So it's a very simple image, but it's also very profound. And he says, for those of you who really desire to be perfect, and remember the word perfect just means in its origin in Latin, thoroughly made, just well, completely made, finished. Something that is perfect is a finished product. That's what it literally means. And he says, if you wish to be perfect, he says, then pursue the more excellent path. I show you the more excellent way. And then, of course, it goes into the famous chapter 13 on charity, on love. The charity is not puffed up. Charity does not seek its own. Charity does not relish evil, but rather celebrates in the truth. So that whole aspect, St. Paul is giving us a very great lesson that each one of us, no matter how small our position may be in this world, in this generation, have great talents and ability and gifts to bring to the benefit of all. So the problem is, it's not for us to be looking to see how we compare to other people, but what is the goodness that is supposed to be manifested by grace in this life, individually me? And that becomes the whole path of charity. Now you can see by the new banners that we have put up this year, for this season, for the summertime, we'll be in pandemic and locked up in our basements for a while, apparently. But we're still going to celebrate the centennial of Mar Ephraim being declared Doctor of the Universal Church in 1920 by Pope Pius XI. It's a fascinating historical moment that century ago. And so we have a very beautiful icon. We give you references of the woman who wrote the icon last year. She lives in Great Britain. And then the other side is in what's called Estrangela. It's not the writing you see in your books. There's actually three different alphabets, manners of writing Syriac. That's the older one. It's a little more complicated than one you have in your book. The one in your book is kind of like the cursive form of Syriac. It's easier to read, actually. But that's what we use for chapters, titles of books. You have a dictionary in Syriac, the writing will be similar to what you have in the Red Missals, but the letters indicating A, B, C, D, the sections, will be in Estrangela. So you have to be able to read both alphabets, in fact. And then there's a third in between those two. So it's the more solemn one. That's why you won't recognize the lettering. But don't worry, it says pretty much the same thing as this size says. We just thought we'd give you a heavier dose of Syriac. Because remember, I told you a month ago, my goal is to make you Maronite and to think like the Syriac church. So, Baruch Mor, we go forward. And so to give you the outline of what we're actually going to do is today we're going to talk about the first of the stages of the spiritual life. Last week we told you all three. This week we will do the beginner stage. Next week we will do the stage and the state in this Christian life of the proficient, those who are truly making progress. And then three Sundays from now, we will solemnize the feast of the great prophet Elijah, which is actually on Monday the 20th. But in the Syriac tradition, is enormous.
We have a proper office for Elijah. We have a proper mass for Elijah. And so we're going to solemnize it by cheating slightly to put it just on the day before so you can benefit of it not being simply during the week. And that week we will touch on the degree, the state of the Christian life of the perfect. So I bring it up because the context is St. Paul says at the end, you desire perfection. You desire to be thoroughly made within the gospel, and that's excellent. But you have to choose the more excellent way, which is not the pettiness of comparing ourselves one to another and keeping up with the Joneses. And so hence he pulls us all back to this understanding of the life. So when we speak about these degrees of life, oh, and then what we'll do actually, I totally forgot about Mar Ephraim. So St. Ephraim, what we'll do after we do Elias, those days following the end of July and in August, week after week, we're going to kind of unfold, I don't know how long, I'm Irish, so I'm pretty long-winded. So the how long we'll go in a series of sermons on St. Ephraim and why he's so important as a declaration of doctor, a teacher of the universal church. And we'll do that through August. Then comes September, when it's a little cooler and we're not baking our brains all the time, we're going to start going through the liturgy from the start to the end, just to explain to you why we do what we do, and what these ceremonies actually mean, why we go to communion, why all these gestures. They all have a meaning behind them. And so that will be going into the fall. And then hopefully, by Easter next year at the latest, you will be singing the Our Father in Aramaic every Sunday morning instead of just reciting it in English. So there. You have the project laid out before you for the next 10 months. Kind of like a marquee at the theater, right? They may not open the theaters and you can't watch movies, but I'll give you a projection of all the things we will consider over these next months together. So let's go back to the question of the first stage, what we call the beginners, of course. We have beginners, proficient, and the perfect. These essentially three stages. And we mentioned again, like last week, they're not chronological. It's not like, well, I hang around and I say my rosary for 10 years and then poof, I go into the proficient stage. They all overlap. It's just that obviously, chronologically, in the beginning, we're going to be mostly beginner. But as we develop our prayer life and the spiritual life and our receptivity to the Spirit of God that St. Paul speaks about so much in the epistle today, we begin to become more proficient into that illuminative stage that we talked about, that we mentioned last week. That the fathers in the Syriac tradition call psychical, psyche, the spirit, the mind. And then, of course, in the perfect is what we call the unitive stage, when we live in this conscious presence of God. And, of course, the Syriac fathers will call this the spiritual state, or the spiritual stage. And just what we want to consider on this first stage of beginners is that what we're doing is we're laying on a foundation and we're establishing ourselves in a path that we can follow until the day we croak, until the day we fall over into the grave, of disposing ourselves, as St. Isaac of Nineveh says, of the laying of a foundation in the pursuit of all goodness. And so the beginning is linked, if you want, with the parable of the prodigal son. You won't know the prodigal son, right? He takes his father's inheritance. He goes off, goes to the big towns, and then just simply wastes it all on partying and on prostitutes. And so his father is half of the inheritance. His brother still has the other half of the inheritance, but he's wasted it all. And there's a moment when he's slopping pigs. And he does two things, and the fathers point out. He does two things while he's slopping pigs. One, the term that's used in the gospel is he comes to himself. He finally thinks about really who he is and where he's at, slopping pigs. These things are unclean under the law of Moses. This is degrading. So he does one thing is to understand who he truly is and how he's been acting these last months, using his father's money essentially. To realize one's true state. Where am I at this moment in 2020? And the second thing we're told is he begins to think about the servants in his father's household. He begins to think about the fact, I'm slopping pigs here, I'm starving, my clothes are a mess, and the servants in my father's house are eating three meals a day, and they have clothing that's not full of holes and pig poo all over them. So he's thinking about the servants in his father's house, the good things that they have. So the very beginning of the spiritual life is to realize, one, is to come to the realization of who I am really, not in comparison with other people, but where am I and where should I be after so many decades of being Catholic, being baptized? And then to consider the goodness of what God has held out and has given already to the saints of God, to those who have been profoundly faithful within the spiritual life. Because that is going to be the goal, saying, I am not where I am supposed to be, and I need to move towards those good things that are promised to me if only I show that reciprocity of love and fidelity. So that, in a nutshell, really is the beginner stage. Is to come to the, it's the qualification of it really is this idea of goodwill to correspond with God's grace that is being given to us. This desire that God lead me. We spend our lives, we know this, we spend our lives making programs. We spend our lives organizing things in our head. We become anxious over it, we become neurotic over it, we get upset by things. And we spend our lives then trying to put it in action, which usually means manipulating other people to make sure that these plans go the way they're supposed to go according to my head. But of course, the problem is everyone else is doing the same thing. So we spend this time slamming into each other, trying to manipulate, trying to make it go the way it is supposed to go. And then when it doesn't go that way, we get upset. And we don't like God. And we don't like our neighbor. We live our lives in constant turmoil and agitation. And what our Lord says in the Sermon on the Mount, which is the foundation of the spiritual life, is sufficient to the day is the evil thereof. Learn how to be holy now, today, not next Tuesday, today. And that's enough. God's not asking us to be a saint last Wednesday. If I didn't do it last Wednesday, all right, it's gone. I can't fix that. But today. So the real quality of the aspect is this goodwill corresponding with God's initiative and grace, who is trying to draw us forward. Remember in the parable of the prodigal son, we're told that the father is always watching, each day waiting for that loser's son to finally come back. He's waiting. God initiates this work within our lives. And he's waiting for us to respond so that he can develop the goodness in our lives that he has desired to do from all eternity. So really the characteristic of the first degree is self-knowledge. That our daily prayer should be before the light of God saying, teach me who I am. Not who my spouse is, not who my children are, not who my parents are, what my parents did to me 30 years ago, but who am I here now? Because I can't start if I don't have self-knowledge. If I live in illusion, everything is going to be touched by illusion. Everything is going to be touched by falsification to the degree that I have a false understanding of my self-knowledge. This is why in the beginner's state of life, the daily examination of conscience is so important. It's not about navel gazing, or as Pope Francis mentioned, a laundry list that you just take with you into our prayers and in the sacrament of penance. It is to come to a self-knowledge of who we are and where we're at. The examination of conscience that we do on a daily basis is not navel gazing. It's to see in my life, in thought and word and in deed, or absence of deed, of the obstacles that stand in my way of truly becoming profoundly rooted within the gospel. That's the examination of conscience. And that's why it's so important. So that once I can begin to see and know myself, then God can actually start to work on us. So there is the mental confession of our sins. We examine ourselves to see where we are at. And then, of course, there's the verbal confession of our sins in the divine mysteries and in the sacrament, the mystery of penance. Because the two qualities of this state of beginning is self-knowledge, of course, which leads to repentance. That I change where I'm at. The word that is used in the Greek that we translate with the word repentance. And unfortunately, we say the word repentance and everyone kind of like, ugh, nah, it's painful. It's not painful, it's healing. And the Greek term is so much better representative, which is metanoia. Nous is the mind. Metanoia is the action of changing your attitude, changing the mind. I don't say changing the mind in English because when we say that, it's just someone who's like flip-flopping all over the place. So metanoia in changing the attitude, the way we see things, the way we see ourselves, the way we see our relations with others, this is the state of the beginner in the spiritual life. Now some of you may be scratching your head and saying, that sounds pretty perfect to me already. But in fact, it's only a beginning because the proficient and the perfect levels, God has so much more that he wants to do in us and through us in our lives. So the beginning qualities are self-knowledge. Lord, let me see myself as you see me. And the second is, give me the strength to change my attitude, the metanoia to change my mind in that way that I now see differently. That is the beginning stage. And the fathers of the church, for that reason, they will say there are two gifts that will come during the beginning stage. One is mourning. We are sad for the things, those opportunities of grace that I missed when I was 28. That moment in grace that I can remember when I was 37, and it's gone. And all I can do is weep for it. What would my life look like if I had acted differently on that 43rd year of my life? Those are the aspects. It's not to be sad. It's to recognize the goodness that has been in my life that I missed, or that I screwed up, or that I lost and it passed and it's gone. That's mourning. And the other for the fathers is they talk about the gift of tears. Saint Arsenius was a father in the desert, not a fashion designer. And Arsenius had been tutor to the imperial brats, and they were brats. They grew up to become emperors, and they were really bad emperors. Their father was a great emperor, Theodosius. The boys, not so much. Arsenius was their tutor. In the midst of all of the beauty of the perfumes, the fragrance, the incense, the silks, the fine food, the marble, the mosaics, and all the beauty of the palace, he leaves it all. And he goes out into the desert to learn. In his mature years, what we would call middle age, he leaves behind a really posh job, and he goes out to these unwashed hermits living in the wilderness. And he goes to one of the monasteries that's being governed by Abba Yohanan, Father John. And he's a dwarf, actually. So this little tiny, kind of misshapen man, he's in charge of the religious life of all of these men out here. And Arsenius shows up, decked out in his best, you know, silk and everything else, because he's coming from the palace. That's the clothing he has. And he comes into the community in the morning, and he asks Abba John to give me direction, teach me salvation. This is a man who's already baptized, been baptized for decades. And Abba John just looks at him and he says, well, we have our meal now. You can come if you want. And when they go in, their tables are lined up along this room, like a monastery today, even though we're talking about the 4th century. And the man stands in the middle. And they say their prayers for the beginning of the meal, and they open up the prayers. And of course, everything is in silence. The monks aren't talking, but they say their prayers all together. And Abba John picks up one of the loaves of bread, not our Wonder Bread, you know, but pita, the big flat loaves. And he picks it up, so it's frisbee-like, and he throws it at Saint Arsenius. He throws it at Arsenius, and he says, eat if you want. That's your welcome to the monastery. They threw the bread at you. as you stand in the middle of the room. But Arsenius does something. In fact, he does nothing. He simply sits down cross-legged on the ground without saying a word and begins to eat the bread. He doesn't complain. He's not indignant. He doesn't rage at this little dwarf of, how can you treat me like that? I am the imperial tutor. No. He knows who he is. He's beginning to know who he is. And so he simply sits down and eats the bread in silence with no complaint. And Abba John leans over to the man, the monk who is next to him. And he says, this one, I will take him. Who is going to be my spiritual father? Who is going to lead me? That's the idea of why Arsenius came. And Abba John said, I will teach this one. Because he's impressed. He begins well. But Arsenius, I give it to you as an example. Because Arsenius was known for the gift of tears. And the rest of his life, like St. Peter after betraying our Lord, just wept, continually weeping. It's said of St. Peter that he finished his years later on. You know, we always get crow's feet and troughs all over the place. Well, his troughs were down his cheeks because he had wept for decades after this betrayal of our Lord. And Arsenius is also known for this. In fact, Arsenius was so well known for the gift of tears as he lived as a hermit that apparently his eyelashes fell out, which sounds a little peculiar. But obviously the detail stood out because it was peculiar. And when Arsenius was known weaving baskets, because you sell baskets in town, it's something easy you can do and keep praying because it's redundant. That's why they make the baskets, take mats in, take the baskets in. They have palms out in the desert. Sell them, buy the bread or other supplies they need, and they go back to their hermitage. Well, when you're sitting there, you have a bucket full of water, and you put the palm fronds in them so they become soft. You all know what your palms look like on Wednesday after Palm Sunday, right? So you can't do much with them, they just break. So the palms are being soaked to keep them wet so you can weave them. And while most of the monks on occasion would just dump all of the water out and change the water and make it clean, Arsenius would just top it off. So you can imagine all of the kind of organic sludge and the stench that was in this water after years of never being completely changed, just topped off. And so people would come to St. Arsenius and they would ask for a word, teach me. And while they're standing there, of course, they're like completely repulsed and disgusted by this bucket of whatever, this stench coming out of this rotting vegetation. And so finally, one of the men who had come out to see Arsenius, Abba Arsenius, they're like, finally, Father, why don't you change the water? And he simply looked at him with those lashless eyes, and he said, oh, you know, in the years that I spent in the palace, it was always beautiful. Incense being burned in the hallways and in the halls, the fine food, the perfumed women, everything that was around, we had the finest of all of the aromas of anywhere in the world that you could have. And I loved it. And I loved it too much. And so I allow what creation has of this decomposition to remind me that all things pass. Well, this man obviously was so impressed. This story went in, you heard it today, 1600 years later. This is the beginner's stage, mourning, tears for what could have been if I had only been more faithful to grace, and the desire for self-knowledge, that our Lord open my mind, open my eyes, open my ears of the soul to be able to see myself as God sees me. Not to wait for judgment day for that to be manifested, but that I see it now. That's the stage of beginners. And what I leave you with is a quotation from Saint Isaac of Nineveh. Blessed is the man who knows his own sickness, because this knowledge becomes for him the very foundation, the root, and the beginning of all goodness. May his prayers be a rampart to us always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, who is
Telot madem he daloho, alot aloho dem panitanio, enem sugo taibuto, heul el baito quescu dem paeclo, od codisho.
mighty Lord and God, you accepted the offerings of our ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the Chosen One, Saints Mary and Saint Jude and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the remembrance of all this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. Continue with the anaphora of St. Peter on page 774, 774. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Father, God of peace and Lord of security, make us worthy to embrace one another with a sincere kiss in the spirit of your unending love, that we may raise glory and thanks to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to your holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit. Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor, love and faith that are pleasing to God. O Lord, we bow before you to receive your blessings and assistance, for we are weak, and you are the support and refuge of all. We raise glory to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, may the light of your face shine upon us. Deliver us from every evil and blot out all our transgressions, that we may raise glory and thanks to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility. Truly it is right and just to glorify, exalt You, O Maker of all creation. With the angels we glorify You, and with voices of praise we cry out and we proclaim. Because of Your love for us, You sent Your Son into the world, and He became flesh of the Virgin Mary for our salvation. Kyrie eleison, qua biaumo hauductum hasho dilemma bed chaye, en save lachmo minau cori shonto, O Baruch Hu Kodesh, Vaksoya Biletalmitao Kado Mara, Sabachula Mehne Kulhu, Hono Denitao, Fahuru Hodil, Dachlofaiku, Wachlof Sagie. Metaseu metihem, Husoyon, Homewa Hoyed al Alam Alamin. O Pando Alcoso Damsiko men Hamro who men Mayo. Baruch Hu Kodesh, Yabel Talmidao Kado Mara, Sabishtawa Mehne Kulhu, Hono Denitao, Bimoho Dila Diatiki Hadato, Dahlo Faikun, Wahlo Sagiye. Ete shedu meti hemd, Husoyon hame wa hoyen al alam alamin. He then commanded and instructed them, saying, each time you celebrate these holy mysteries, you remember my death and resurrection until I come again. Saved us, and as we await Your second coming, we offer You praise, and we ask You, on the day when You will judge the righteous and the sinners, do not condemn us because of our sins, but have compassion and mercy upon us. Turn Your holy face away from our sins and assist us. For this Your holy church implores You, and through You and with You, He implores Your Father, saying,
have mercy on us, O mighty Father. Have mercy on us.
sinful children, receive your graces. We thank you for them and because of them. Descent, he may make this bread the body of Christ, our God.
Amen.
And make the mixture in this chalice the blood of Christ, our God.
Amen.
May those who share in these holy mysteries be cleansed, body and soul, from every sin and receive eternal life. O Lord, accept our intercessions and prayers, and grant security to your people and peace to your flock. Protect our shepherds, Francis, the Pope of Rome, the Shadow Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, and Gregory John, our Bishop. Assist the priests, the deacons, and all those who serve your Holy Church, so that they may intercede and pray to you on our behalf. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have asked us to pray for them, those who desired but were unable to make an offering, and those who assist your holy church. Be a shelter and a refuge for them, for you are the Savior of all. We pray to you, O Lord. Remember, O Lord, the civil leaders in our country and throughout the world. Enlighten their consciences to bring security and peace to your people. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the Holy Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Marin, and all the saints. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy of their reward. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the righteous fathers and teachers who have gone to their rest among the saints. Remember those who diligently carried your gospel throughout the whole world and confirmed your holy church in the true faith. Assist us through their prayers and strengthen us in your love. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember, O Lord, our parents, brothers and sisters, teachers, and all the faithful departed here and everywhere who have gone to their rest. Forgive us and forgive them of all offenses, sins and offenses. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
And rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, live without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever.
Lord, you are the pleasing oblation.
Who offered yourself for us. You are the forgiving sacrifice. Who offered yourself to your Father. You are the high priest. Who offered yourself as the Lamb. Through your mercy, may our prayer rise like incense, which we offer to your Father forgiving you. To you be glory and praise.
O God the Father, you strengthen and you encourage us, for we are weak. We implore you to purify us from every sin and to accept our offering, so that in one spirit we may call upon you praying, Our Father, not into the trials of temptation that we do not have the strength to overcome, but deliver us from every evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And
O Lord, bless your worshippers who bow before you and who implore you. Make them worthy of your mercy and forgive all their sins. For you are almighty and rich in compassion. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your Lord,
and our souls purified.
May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Those angels that come stand with us, and all the
angels,
they sing chorus, prepare to Christ the Lamb, sacrifice before us. O come receive him, save the Lamb of God, who will grant.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, O compassionate and merciful one. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Oh,
Thank you, O Father, for this gift that you have given us, though we are unworthy. Do not shame us because of our sins, but help and save us, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you. Lord Jesus, stretch forth your right hand and bless your people. Protect them by your life-giving cross. Be their shelter and refuge, and perfect them with your abundant blessings, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your blessed Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. So one last announcement amongst all your new faces. You recognize that there is a window above the altar. That's a whole nother sermon eventually. But what we're trying to do is actually restore it as a window because the electrical lighting is actually all broken out. So, among you, if there is someone who has electrician or electrical skills, our beloved seminarian has been working for hours along with the sacristan trying to fix this window. And we would be more than obliged if you were to show your God-given talents to help our seminarian and our sacristan restore it to its primitive glory. They give you the details. Don't worry about it. Go in peace. Oh, and the last announcement, you can stay to remain to pray, but those who wish to visit, please take outside. But there are muffins and coffee coming in September, so you actually will be able to meet each other over tables eventually. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and the blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever. Amen.